live across this big, brown, flat, mysterious, crazy country, Powerade Title Burst presents Martin Malloy with Mick Malloy and Tony Martin.
And today, who spilled Powerade Title Burst all over the sacred Olympic flag? We attempt to get to the bottom of Staingate. Also, Mick jumps on board the first of those public tours of the lodge in Canberra. We've got the latest contraceptive breakthrough from Martin Malloy Laboratories, and a very special mystery politician joins us for today's round of True Confessions. On Radio Gladiators, we'll be once again trawling for top nights, and joining us live online from the Edinburgh Festival, it's Judith Lucy. Yes, it's all coming up on the program. State member for Mansfield and Queensland, Frank Carroll, describes as smut, smut, smut. And who are we to disagree? Martin Malloy. Fast love, that's George Michael. Good afternoon, Australia, and welcome aboard yet another week. It just won't go away. It's that Martin Malloy with myself, Tony Martin, and this bloke here. The man who over the weekend fessed up. Yes, he was parked in Sydney's George Street on Friday afternoon. A bird crapped on his windscreen. He didn't have a chamois cloth. The Olympic flag was handy. He apologises, Mick Malloy.
Oh, what do you do, Tone? You just, you know, make the most of the situation and look at the trouble.
Yeah.
Look at the trouble.
Well, let's start there, shall we, Mickey? I'm calling it Staingate. How did the most sacred and carefully guarded of all Olympic artefacts come to be marked with what they're calling a giant sausage-shaped grease stain? Now, did you see it being hoisted at Sydney's Town Hall? What an embarrassment.
Yeah, not a good look.
Nah, Bob Carr pulled the cord, and as the massive 2x3 metre Olympic treasure unfurled, you just saw about $1.50 worth of hot chips fall out of it, a couple of Pepsi cans rolled across the dais, some open sachets of White Crow fell out, a half-finished tub of coleslaw. I mean, somebody had been using it as a tablecloth. It looked like Marlon Brando's shirt front after a couple of souvlakis. And, of course, there was the mystery stain, which Sydney Lord Mayor Frank Sartor tried to claim adds to the character of the flag. Nice try, Frank. Stains really add character to anything, I find. I think Mayor Sartor must be a former real estate agent, because whenever they use the word character to describe something, it usually means it's covered in crap and sinking into the ground. Your underpants are full of character, aren't they, Mickey?
Remarkably so.
Chockers with character. New Drive Liquid, guaranteed to rid your smalls of all that unwanted character. Remember when that oil tanker spilled all that character into the sea off the West Coast? But I'm sorry, it wasn't a display of character. It was as though Juan Antonio Samaranch had stepped up to the podium to announce the venue for the 2004 Games, not realising his fly was open. You know, if the stain had been in the shape of Juan's face, they might have got away with it. The Shroud of Samaranch. Now, as soon as the Olympic skid mark was discovered, the investigations began with a full retracing of the flag's steps.
Right.
It had been collected in Atlanta by Mayor Sartor, using a very long set of barbecue tongs, I'm guessing. Mm-hmm. And for the flight to Sydney, listen to this, the flag was carefully rolled, wrapped in black satin, placed in a locked mahogany box, which was then sealed in a yellow diplomatic pouch, which was kept throughout the flight in a compartment behind the pilot's seat in the cockpit. Mind you, it was, even with all that, still easier to get out than one of those packets of airplane cutlery that comes with your so-called meal. Maybe that's what happened. The co-pilot's looking for his serviette. Gee, they wrap these bastards up, don't they? Now, upon arrival in Sydney, the flag never left the mayor's sight apart from a few minutes when he took a bath at the airport Sheraton on Friday morning. Mm. Could he have mistaken it for a towel when he stepped out of the bath?
Yeah.
You know, he's got soap in his eyes, he reaches around blindly, grabs what he thinks is a large bath towel, starts doing the old ass-drying shimmy. Oh, my God! Anyway, between Frank's bath and the hoisting ceremony, the only other person to touch the flag with their bare hands was Premier Carr. All the athletes who carried it in the parade used surgical gloves. Did you see them?
No, I didn't see that.
I'm going, look, Samantha Riley's come straight from her gig at the Olympic sandwich shop. Now, unless someone hit the flag with a well-aimed egg from a fourth-story window, which to me would have been gag of the century, that went begging that opportunity. Bob Carr is the only suspect. Could he have tripped with a cappuccino? Is that a possibility? Well, no, listen to this. It's immaterial because photographs have turned up today which prove that, yes, The flag was like that when we got it. It's nothing to do with us. The flag was already imbued with character before the mayor took possession in Atlanta, and the stain may have originated during the closing ceremony.
Oh.
Gee, what happened there? I can only think of three possibilities. President Clinton dropped his McDonald's value pack during the handover. The flag was run over by an Aussie kid on an out-of-control BMX, or it was accidentally used as a nappy by Muhammad Ali.
Oh,
What is love? That's Hadaway here at Martin Malloy. And, Mick, what's going on in Canberra? I understand there's exciting news for the punters.
Yes, Tone, the big news from Canberra. Have you heard about this? Forget gun laws, forget budget cuts. In what can only be described as a bold new initiative, the government have opened up the Prime Minister's official residence, the Lodge, to members of the paying public. Now you can roll up and take a guided tour of the Prime Ministerial pad.
Oh, yes.
And I'm thinking, they'll try anything, won't they? They'll try anything, this government, to make a buck. I'm sure they've had a look and seen how many people make the pilgrimage to Gracelands each year and thought, hey, let's get some of that action. Okay, so there's no pink Cadillac in the garage or shag pile on the walls, but you can see the television Mr. Howard shot with a handgun during a 7:30 report hosted by Kerry O'Brien.
Oh, yeah.
I actually took the tour on the weekend, Tone.
Did you? How'd it go, Mickey?
Not too well.
Really?
In fact, it's a bit embarrassing, but well, I was caught scarfering over the back fence with their VCR.
Oh,
it was a rush of blood to the head, Tone. It was there. They weren't around. I was keen to see if I still had the old touch.
That's very irresponsible. That VCR's coming out of Peter Costello's hole, I have you know that.
I know. Anyway, look, I've got to say, it was the only highlight in the tour I'd otherwise describe as being fairly crap.
Really?
All you do is walk around checking out their stuff. Which is okay, but it'd be better if the family were there just going about their business. Do you know what I mean? That's what I was expecting.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, you know, if you could push back the bathroom door to reveal the PM on the bog of pants around the ankles reading an old bulletin or something and squeeze a couple of snaps off at the same time, now that'd be something.
Yeah, to get the kiddies in.
There you go. If you could join them for a meal then crash on the couch and watch Water Rats with them, well, that'd be worth the price of admission.
Yeah.
Then you could either do a runner before it's time to wash up or just say, it's been a long day, excuse yourself, and head upstairs for a kip. You know what I mean, Tone?
Yeah.
Half the fun of touring the lodge, I would have thought, would have involved hanging out with the Howards,
fighting
over who's got the remote, poking around in the bottom of the fridge, getting in trouble for taking too long in the shower and using all the hot water, refusing to get out of bed in the morning, doing the old, I can't, just another 5 minutes, Mrs. Howard, asking Johnny if you can borrow the keys to the car with a flag on the bonnet.
Yeah.
But the bums aren't even there.
Oh.
One of the highest actors. Like they do at Sovereign Hill. Now, that's a tourist attraction. Set in the Gold Rush days, they've got actors dressed to the nines in ye olde clobber panning for gold. I mean, would it have been too much trouble to pay some bloke who looks a bit like a tubby Rick Moranis to swan round the joint barking out a few orders? What about animatronics? They've got them at the Ned Kelly homestead. How about getting some Sparkies to knock up an electronic Howard family? Surely you could do that without losing the family's natural charisma. Not enough thought has gone into the presentation, Tone. For example, okay, we all get to walk around the joint, which is fine, but what if you laid down some track and toured it in carriages like the ghost train? Drop a few skeletons from the roof, play some maniacal laughter through the sound system, have a life-size Amanda Vanstone lurch out of a cupboard with their latest draft of her education policy.
You've gone too far.
That's frightening. What about a really evil, spooky effigy of Peter Costello? What about the real Peter Costello? Just walking down the hallway. People would be hanging on for their lives with white knuckles. It could be better than the Batman ride at Warner Brothers Movie World.
Yes.
Not enough thought, Tone.
No.
Not enough thought. No. Anyway, if you want to go and you want to have a look, the tour's on at the lodge. It's all day on the hour. And once again, I apologise for that little episode with the VCR.
Hang on. Just before you leave that particular area, Mickey, could you just lift your jumper up?
What do you mean?
What's going? Lift it up.
Here we go.
Is that the Howard cutlery?
All right. I'll take it back. Was that fault? I left it out.
Closer to free, that's the Bodines here at Martin Malloy. The program, which has been attacked in the press as being nothing but smut. Well, I I refuse to accept that, Mickey. I refuse to accept that there's any truth to that whatsoever.
Hey, guys. Looking for a contraceptive that's effective, sensitive, and got a cheeky sense of fun about it? Then get yourself a packet of Martin Malloy Balloon Animal Condoms. The days of fumbling around in the dark like a hapless clown just when things start getting messy are a thing of the past thanks to these little babies, which have turned the awkward and often embarrassing procedure of donning a condom into a show-stopping highlight of even the most steamy of sessions. You'll know when the time is right to impress your lady, not only with your sensible approach to safe sex, but also with the hastily constructed giraffe now clinging to your pecker. Allow me to demonstrate the amazing versatility of this revolutionary new product. Please, meet my good friend, the billy goat. Or, how about the squirrel to get the juices flowing? And lads, trust me when I tell you, you'll never go home empty-handed once you've gone to work on the sausage dog. Now that's man's best friend. What's that I hear you say? Looks difficult? Well, it's not. Because each packet of Balloon Animal Condoms comes complete with easy-to-follow instructions and a complimentary puncture kit. Here's what some of our many satisfied customers have had to say about new Balloon Animal Condoms.
Hi, I'm Dave, and my partner didn't seem overly interested in sex, but when I pulled back the sheets to reveal a meticulously crafted melon head whale, she was putty in my hands. Thanks, Martin Malloy.
G'day. Not only have I had incredible sex every night since using these condoms, I've also managed to win red faces. Thanks, guys.
Lots of guys can make love like a tiger, but look, I can make love with a tiger.
So, for the ultimate contraceptive experience, grab a packet of Martin Malloy Balloon Animal Condoms. They'll bring out the animal in anyone.
Wait! What about protection?
Allow me.
Wow, check out the antlers on that.
China Phillips here at Martin Malloy, where Radio Gladiators is imminent. I think we're talking top nights again today.
Beautiful.
So get them ready, get them tooled up. We'll also have the True Confessions booth. It'll be moving in here in the next hour. Chockers, as always, your chance to win or put yourself in the running for that trip to the UK. Mm. And also, Judith Lucy will hopefully be online from Edinburgh. I think the Edinburgh Festival kicked off a couple of days back.
So we'll have some news from her.
And I'm not sure if Jude's show's open yet, but we'll get some gossip from Scotland.
Absolutely.
From Judith. And
the Jude show would have begun as soon as she arrived in Edinburgh, Tony Martin. Make no mistake about it.
That's right. It's an ongoing performance installation. There is no show. You just find Jude and you hang around and you pay your money. And you see what happens.
Wherever she turns up, automatically there's a comedy festival in progress.
Already there's reviews.
Yeah.
Her arrival at the hotel was a tour de force. Anyway, I've got to get to this letter because somebody's written
it's been
to
bugging
us.
Bugging you, hasn't it?
It has indeed. Stephanie Milner is one of our very fine listeners in Queensland and Ipswich, and she sent us in this little article we've been alluding to on the show today. Mm. It's from over a week ago, but people have been keeping it from us.
Mm.
Probably a good idea too. Listen to this headline. This is from Brisbane newspaper. I think it's the Sunday Mail. Radio smut is no laughing matter. Brisbane radio station B105, that's where we're heard in Brisbane for the rest of the country, played garbage, and its announcers were attempting to be humorous with smut, a state Liberal politician said yesterday. The member for Mansfield, Frank Carroll, attacked the station's drive-time program, Martin Malloy, is not even funny. Well, that's nothing compared to what my mum says about this show. So, Frank, you've got a long way to go.
That's mild criticism.
And that's, I think, the phrase on our new newspaper advertisement. I think it might be. The show, blah, 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 says Mr. Carroll, they are trying to be humorous with smut. He did not usually listen to B105, but was forced to when he used the parliamentary gym. And it's not just us he's having a go at. He also attacks the ABC's youth network, Triple J, which he says should have a fire hose put through it.
Mm.
We've often had a fire hose put through this station, but that's just our Friday night hijinks.
That's a prank.
And he says the people who listened to Triple J were only the only people who listened to Triple J were people who were desperate to be titillated by something that touches their sense of scandal or intrigue.
Mm.
Now, when I was living in Queensland, when you wanted scandal and intrigue, you had to look at what Queensland politicians were up to, buddy. Oh, yeah. So have a look at your own backyard there.
This is the pot calling the kettle black tea, Martin.
And he goes on, referring again to Martin Molloy, no one could say that crudity and lewdness ever created anything good, and he says people should turn over to Christian radio stations.
Well, there you go.
And now I take issue with, not the comments about this program, because they're all true. I'm not denying that. I take issue with the comment that no one could say that crudity and lewdness created anything good. Have a look at Australian culture. It's built. That's the foundation of Australian culture.
The keystone.
Crudity and lewdness. You know, from Don's Party to Celeste Patterson to Patrick White to Kevin Bloody Wilson. It's just crudity. Crudity. Lewdness. Lewdness.
But it's the pot calling the kettle black. I mean, I'm a grown man, but I can't listen to Question Time in Parliament without blushing like a beetroot. If there's any mouth here that needs to be washed out, there's a bar of soap in the mail with your name in it, Frankie boy.
Well,
we're stealing his thunder. That's what he's up to. Smack on the radio. That's our job. What are they doing?
Well,
crazy kids.
The most revealing comment, I think, in the whole article is Mr. Carroll said he did not usually listen to the Martin Molloy program, but was forced to when he used the parliamentary gym. So they got this show on. In the gym. Firstly, the idea that they've got a gym in the Queensland Park, that was obviously put in when Russ Hinge was around. Obviously.
Oh, yeah.
And the idea that it's on at the moment. So what? Queensland politicians jumping up and down on the Stairmaster listening to this right now. Give him some music, Gracie. Come on, you flabby-ass Brisbane pollies. Move those legs if you want to be as fit as Frank Tandy. You're going to have to do better than that.
Come on, you pussies. We're not tabling documents now. We're pumping iron. All those in favour say aye. I can't hear you. Come on, member for Mansfield. Give me 50 chin-ups. And that's 50 per chin, buddy. All ass.
I don't think it's appropriate music if you're addressing Frank Carroll. Here's some fitness music for
Got
Frankie.
Got myself a crying, talking, sleeping, walking, living doll.
So you'd be enjoying yourself now, wouldn't Got you, Frankie?
We're trying harder, Frank. We're really trying.
This is Martin Molloy.
Both beautifully presented in stylish furniture cabinets.
Brought to you by Powerade Tidal Burst, the seriously cool green power source.
This is Martin Molloy. Sorry, Mickey. I'm in a bit of pain today.
What's going on?
So I had the operation we were talking about on the show a few weeks back. I've had the van stones out. And it's very hard to sit down. It's a very painful and lengthy series of cuts.
Oh, yeah, I can imagine.
And they're only done out of spite. There's not actually any reason for them.
It's quite costly, though.
Indeed. But that doesn't sound like a cue for it, but let's have it anyway.
Radio Gladiators, your chance to represent your state and win fame, glory, and fabulous prizes. Here's today's challenge.
That's nothing, mate. On the weekend, I got totally van-stoned. Oh, yeah. I was under this delusion all the time. I was doing really well. And, oh, man.
Well, some friends...
Got the munchies.
The reason for all the van-stoned talk is because a friend of mine over the weekend, I couldn't go. I was kicking myself. He had an Amanda Vanstone party. Seriously, everyone had to come dressed as Amanda Vanstone. And that's one set of photographs I'm looking forward to. I'm a Vanstone craze at the moment. I can't get enough of her work because she's only got one answer to any question. We won the election and you didn't. Have you noticed that? No matter what the question is, that's her answer.
We won the election.
She was on Paul Lynham's little segment on Channel 9 Friday night, and he was throwing curly questions at her, and every answer was, well, we won the election, and you didn't. It was like, Kim Beazley says that, in fact, your cuts will mean that thick people can go to university and smart people who haven't got any money can't. Yeah, well... Kim Beazley's attending a meeting in Canberra today to find out why he lost the election so badly. And then they've said, but isn't this a broken election promise? Well, not as broken as selling the Commonwealth Bank. It's just a standard answer to anything.
Yeah,
it could be, Mrs. Vanstone, you know, what are you wearing? Oh, well, I don't know, but we won the election and you didn't. That's her standard answer.
You've made your point.
But dressing up as Amanda Vanstone and going along to a party, you know what that sounds like, Mickey?
Mm.
Top night.
Sounds like a top night if ever I heard one. And that's what we want to hear about on Radio Gladiators today. We want to hear what you got up to over the weekend that may well be described, which well could constitute a top night. A top night. Did you have a top night over the weekend, Mickey?
Yeah, I did, but for all the wrong reasons. Can I tell you a story?
Yeah.
I feel like I need the confessional. No, don't wheel it in. No, we'll...
Are you sure?
Yeah, go on, bring it in. Bring in the confessional. Get in quickly. This will be over in a second. All right.
Tone,
where'd you
be
on the video?
Hang on,
I
haven't owned the wooden slidey door.
Broken protocol.
Where's the wooden slidey door? All right, okay.
Hello. Can you hear me?
All right, what are you going to confess to?
Tone went down to the video shop and pulled out a little film called Back and Beyond.
Oh, that's an Australian film, isn't it?
It's an Australian film. Well, I thought we've been hard.
Yeah, I know.
We've been going hard Australian films. Give them the benefit of the doubt. Could be a top night. Well, I don't need to tell you when I returned.
Hang on a second. How did you get there? But you've got it out.
I'm okay. In the confessional booth, Tone. Okay. Remember that.
Saturday night, you've rented Back and Beyond.
I've rented Back and Beyond. And we're not taking it back. Oh, I've been sure to put it in the comedy section. We're looking at Paul Mercurio, Tone, and this is the reason you'll get it out, people. Go out and have a look at one of the Super Mario Brothers make a total dick of himself for an hour and a half. It's a disgrace. All I can remember is you're not allowed to touch his bike.
Don't touch my bike. Now you get half an hour and half of that. Hey, don't touch my bike. No one wants to touch your bike, you pill. Give it a rest. Hey. Don't touch my bike.
This is your hero. This is the guy. The chase sequence, there's a huge chase sequence. It's all coming to the end. And the guy comes running out of this petrol station in the outback, shooting at a car. And the poor Mercurio pops up in his overalls just in front of him and goes, "Hey, mate, want a drink?" Oh, well done. Roll credits.
Good.
You've diffused the whole thing beautifully.
So what you're saying is in Hollywood they've got Hasta La Vista, baby.
Yeah.
We've got Don't Touch My Bike.
Don't touch my bike. You want a drink?
Well, I am not exaggerating. If you want to go and see a special child in overalls who spends an hour and a half on the sulk, go and have a look at Back and Beyond and see what our great film finance corporations are sinking their cash into.
Is that right?
Straight back to the comedy section, too. I've had a great laugh, don't get me wrong. Tears are streaming from my eyes for all the wrong reasons.
And, Mickey, you've certainly lowered the bar for the listeners. Can they go better? I better tell you about my topic.
Please do.
Have we got time?
Come on.
Now, as you know, I'm not a celebrity name dropper. I don't come on the show and talk about all celebrity stuff. I don't move in celebrity circles apart from about once a month of a Saturday night. I'll hit the town with Norman Yim and we'll just get shit-faced. But I don't like to talk about
that. Get in the booth.
But... But I did actually get invited out for a bit of a bite to eat on Saturday night by Andrew Denton.
Oh, yeah.
And the only reason I mention this is because I hadn't realised how funny it would look, me and Andrew Denton, walking down the street together until I actually got there and the comments started flying from the general public.
Oh, yeah.
And it was, "Hey, where's your brother, mate?" It was just a lot of that. And the best one, someone yelled from a car, "Check it out, the Proclaimers!" So I think that's certainly a top night. Perhaps not for me or Andrew, but certainly for a number of passing motorists. Okay, let's talk about prizes, shall we? Yes, step into the prize lounge, and thank you very much, the Martin Malloy Singers. We've got a cool pair of Bollé Sunnies with your name on them. People, if you've got the toppest of top nights, you'll also go into the draw for that trip for two. Yes, there's another one. Courtesy Qantas to Falls Creek, and thanks to our very good friends at the Diana Lodge. I think, do we know how it's pronounced yet? GEBIS Ski Hire. We're calling it Vanstone Ski Hire. And, of course, thanks very much to our very good friends at Falls Creek itself. Oh, yeah. So call us now with your top night, 1-800-657-657. With Waterfalls, it's Martin Malloy, it's Radio Gladiators, and today we're merely canvassing our listeners to find out who had a top night over the weekend. Who have we got, Mickey?
We got Liz on the line. Hello, Liz.
Hi, how are you?
Not too bad at all. Tell us about your top night.
Okay, Saturday night I was working at the Vinegar Hill Woolshed at Rouse Hill, and we had a great boot scooting winter in July night. And we had a Santa Claus and everything. And he told a pretty good joke up there on stage.
Did Santa do some boot scooting?
Yeah, he did actually. He did a bit of a moonwalk across the floor.
Yeah, that sounds like Father Christmas.
That's Father Christmas we've come to know and love.
And so there was boot scooting going on. It was Christmas in July and Santa told some kind of blue joke. Is that what you're suggesting?
Yeah, he did. Didn't get much reaction from the crowd, though, unfortunately.
Oh, dear. This event wasn't held in the parliamentary gym in Brisbane, was it, by any chance? That's where we're being accused of being smut peddlers. All right, Liz, and it was a top night for all concerned?
Ah, sure was.
Okay, and what about the boot scooting? Are you any good yourself?
Well, we don't actually have to do it. So that was one of the questions I asked when I went to the job interview.
Do I have to boot scoot? Yes, I think we got asked that when we went for this job. You know, can you boot scoot, guys? It's an important
thing. That's all we need to know.
All right.
Good on you, Liz.
Okay, thanks. We'll talk to, in fact, a caller from Brisbane now. Lee, are you there, Lee? Lee, are you with us?
The Leaster.
Oh, no. You know what's happened? Frank Carroll's got to him.
Yeah.
The member for Mansfield. Frank Carroll's gone. You're not going on that little smut fest. You're nicked. All right. And what was Lee's top night? He's a busker.
In the mall?
Yeah.
In Brisbane, right. So obviously a bit of custom arrived. Someone's heaving down a dollar coin in the guitar case.
Yeah. He got a paying gig.
All right. And have we got Melissa in that case? You with us, Melissa?
Yep.
Oh, I think... Can I hear myself in the background?
Yes.
Oh,
so you want to turn your radio down? So I think it's the first time we've actually had to mention that in nearly 2 years of broadcasting, Melissa.
All right, she's just
right. So I've got to turn it down.
Okay, you don't want to be listening to this smut fest anyway. She's popping back. Turn it down! Turn it down! And hurry back! Sorry about that, Melissa.
There you go.
It's not for any technical reason. It's just we can't stand to listen to our own program. Now, tell us about your top night. Oh, she's having to turn the radio back on. Her phone's not working. It's the only line of communication. Mm. This is too confusing.
Hello.
There we go.
Sorry.
All right. Now,
I turned down too much.
Was this a little bit of confusion, anything like your top night, Melissa?
No.
What was your top night?
I went to the Presidents of the USA concert.
How was it?
Excellent, apart from the fact that I nearly got trampled a million times.
Oh, trampled by those Presidents fans. They get pretty mad.
They do.
Were you down in the mosh pit, were you?
Oh, right near it, actually. I was, like, right in front of it, so...
Right, and were you, when they did Lump, were you changing it to Gump, like so many people seem to enjoy doing? He's Gump!
They were actually, the Presidents themselves actually said they should change the word to jump because everyone was jumping up and down.
Oh, right, okay.
And so they had to go with them or actually couldn't see. So everyone was sort of like jumping and it was just...
Yeah, so and did you, after the show, did you try and get backstage and meet the Presidents in person?
I would have liked to, but we couldn't actually because I was on a bus. I had to go back to the Sunshine Coast.
Oh, right, okay.
Because I'm in Brisbane, so...
Well, that's another whole top night in itself. Well, gee, everyone's called us from Brisbane today. I think we've got yet another caller from Brisbane. In fact, Jeff, are you there, Jeff? Jeff, see, Frank Carroll's got to them all. Anytime we say the caller's from Brisbane, they're just gone. All right,
Jeff's not there?
No sign of Jeff. All right, and his top night involved, all I've got written down here is safari suit. So, that would have won, I think.
Yeah.
It probably would have topped them all. Have we got Kathy on board?
Yes.
Kathy, you're not calling us from Queensland, are you?
No.
Ah, well, see, that's the answer.
Mm-hmm.
Frankie's got connections. And what is your top night involved?
My top night was picking up dog poos off the back lawn with the spotlight on.
Oh, dear.
Spotlighting for dog poo.
And was this a party? Did you invite other people around to partake of this?
Oh, yeah, there was a couple of people watching while I put the rubber gloves on.
Yeah, sounds very exciting. Gee, when you had the rubber gloves on, you didn't subsequent to that go and handle the Olympic flag by any chance?
No, I could have, though.
Because that would have explained it. All right, and is this what you normally do for Saturday night, Kathy?
No, but it's just something that had to be done, so...
Right, are the dogs out of control? Are they your dogs?
Yeah, just one dog, but it had diarrhoea that night, so it was a bit of a mess.
Oh, well, it's good. Does it feel good to have shared that with the entire nation, Kath?
Yeah, it does.
Tone, do you want to press on? Is there a need to press on? Do we have to go any further?
Kathy, I know it's a hard one to top,
but
you just hang in there, because we're going to talk to Cameron. Cameron, did you have yourself a top night?
Mate, did I have a top night? Let me tell you.
What happened?
Well, we said we'll go up the snow, so we're going up to the snow. Yeah. We're heading up there. The chains break. Not good. So take a bit of time. We put them back on.
Right.
Heading up there, and we've got to meet our mate. He's got a lodge up there.
Right.
Yep. So they park at the front of the lodge and come in. Say, "Oh, beauty." Driving up there, got to the stage where it was a little too hard to see. We couldn't see, and we're sitting there. We're going, "Oh, bugger this! We're going to sit in here, drink ourselves a bit silly. We'll stay in the car, and we'll continue on in the morning. We'll go soon."
Oh, no! So far, so good.
In the morning, we're 6 metres away from the lodge.
No! Snowed in, just 6 metres away from the destination.
What are you tapping on the window? What are you guys doing?
You spent the night in the car, covered in snow, 6 metres from the lodge you were supposed to stay at.
Yeah.
What's he won, Tone? Oh, yes, he is our winner today. Guess what? You're in the running for a trip to Falls Creek.
That's what I want to hear.
So you could repeat your performance all over again now.
Am I driving?
Oh, we'll take care of that, I think. We wouldn't trust you behind the wheel, Cameron. And you have, of course, got the Cool Bolle Sunnies.
Thank you.
Thanks for taking part. And we'll be drawing that prize, the trip to Falls Creek, this Friday, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it. That's it for Radio Gladiators. Yay. Thanks to everybody who took part. Thanks, as always, to those who didn't. And we'll be back in the next hour with, True Confessions with our special mystery politician and Judith Lucy.
This is Martin Malloy, brought to you by Powerade Tidal Burst.
And in this hour of Martin Malloy, a very special guest joins us for True Confessions. We'll show you the fastest way to get a piping hot pizza delivered to your door. And next up, we cross to Scotland to make contact with Judith Lucy, all thanks to Powerade Tidal Burst. Yeah, switch it off at the wall. Two sugars for me. Thanks very much, Alanis Morissette, here at Martin Malloy. It's the second hour, and time now to say hello to a woman who's currently representing her country overseas, going for gold at comedy's premier international showcase, the Edinburgh Fringe Festival. Her show, An Impossible Dream, is just one of, get this, 1,238 individual shows jostling for attention this year. Last week when we spoke to her, she'd just done a gig with Rick Wakeman. Let's see if she can go one better. It's Judith Lucy. Judith, can you hear us?
I certainly can, Tone. I'm a little more alert than last week.
Yes, there's been a few faxes and a few comments inquiring after your health.
Well, I'm not entirely surprised. I think it was that mixture of, I don't know, maybe, you know, 10 Valium, 50 Guinnesses, and just no sleep at all.
Oh, you couldn't tell at this end.
No, I'm sure I sounded as perky as.
Now, you've left England. You're in Scotland now. You're in Edinburgh. Before we actually ask you about the town itself, how did you go leaving the hotel? You were telling us that there was some kind of ironing board trouble.
Now, I know you're going to think that I've become slightly obsessed with the ironing board. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's not like my middle name is Miss Domesticity. But remember how I told you you had to put a £20 deposit on the ironing board?
Yeah.
We're talking about an ironing board. It's not like I've said, can I borrow your Mona Lisa? I've asked to borrow the ironing board. And literally, if you turned your back for 50 seconds, the ironing board was gone. It was just whisked away out of your room. So I've actually rung up housekeeping and I've said, listen, would it be possible for me to keep the ironing board until my stay is over? And the woman has just gone, no, that would not only be impossible, that would be illegal. And I've just thought to myself, golly, you know, I was a bit worried about that time when I was strip searched for marijuana, but thank God I haven't been charged with keeping an ironing board in my room. I mean, you know, live fast, die hard, iron on. I just couldn't believe it.
How are you going in Edinburgh with the ironing boards?
Well, let me tell you a little bit about my accommodation, because I'm staying in a couple's house.
Jeez.
And I have walked into the main bedroom and, hello? Two single beds.
Oh, I see. Now, we must explain, round festival time, everyone in Edinburgh just clears out and people come to the festival, stay in their houses, that's right?
That's the story, but I've just walked into this bedroom and I've gone, okay, so either the couple are 9 and 10, or I have walked into Darren and Samantha Stevens' bedroom from Bewitched. It is the most peculiar thing.
I thought that only happened on television. It happens in real life, does it? That's disgusting.
It is disgusting.
People sleeping in separate beds.
So what did you do, Jude? Did you know? Were you confused? Did you lean to the one on the left or the one on the right? Did you try them all out? Did you come home and go, who's been sleeping in my bed?
I just flip a coin every night and see. But, you know, most of the time I don't even make it to the bed, so it's not really a problem.
And who's in the other bed?
Oh, look, that's anybody's guess. That changes nightly.
Yes, that depends on who wins the lucky door prize at an impossible dream.
Absolutely.
And has your show opened itself, Jed?
No, my show hasn't opened, but I did a gig last night that basically if you'd said to me, well, you can do that gig again or you can stick a three-pronged fork up your ass, I reckon I'd go for that.
Was Rick Wakeman involved?
I wish Rick had been there. Rick would have been funnier than me.
Judith, we've just got to do a bit of work with a three-pronged fork ourselves here and
get
a bit of music happening. Can you wait on the line?
Absolutely.
Put a few more coins in the slot. We'll be back to you in a moment on Martin Molloy. And Judith Lucy is still with us online from the glamorous Edinburgh Festival. Are you still there, Jude?
Yep.
Now tell us, have you been nosed down in the papers? Is there anything going on over there we need to know about?
I think there is. I think I was having a look through a magnificent paper called The Sport, and a headline that did catch my eye was, I thought she was my wife, drunken flasher in wrong house.
I see.
And I just thought, if that was the truth, what a top sex life they must have. Look, honey, what had really tripped my trigger tonight is if you just went out, drank a keg of beer, broke into the house just wearing a trench coat, and then went, couple out of this.
I see. Is that the big story over there at the moment?
Well, I wouldn't call it the biggest story. It's sort of, that caught my eye, and I'm afraid I was drawn to that and the editorial page.
What did they have to say?
There's a particular letter here that I might just have to read you.
Oh, yes, please.
It's called, the heading is, Wish I Was a New Key. And it's accompanied by a gorgeous shot of New Key, a lovely sort of tourism shot, which has two beautiful-looking women standing in front of a very picturesque smelter, I think.
Yes.
And they're wearing hats, you know, singlets. They've got their shorts on. They're clutching their ice creams and smiling. They've done that thing, though, that I quite often do, which is they've forgotten to pull their tops down over their breasts.
Oh, right. Yes.
You know what a bugger that can be.
Did you say this is an editorial?
And listen to the letter, and I'm afraid I'm going to have to do it in my worst English accent.
Oh, yes, please.
It's great to hear that more and more people are spending their holidays in this country. Who wants to go abroad amongst all those foreigners anyway? All that sun can kill you. Most of the food tastes like crap. Let's face it, unless you've got a pair of tits, a nice ass, and slack knicker elastic, the Greeks and Spaniards don't want to know. It's easier to bugger off home from Newquay or Blackpool if you're pissed off.
Signed, Margaret Thatcher.
But I'm sorry, the line that got me was, the food is crap. I just thought, coming from an English person, is that because the Spaniards and Greeks have gone, fibre, there's a good idea.
That's like someone in Beirut saying, oh, you don't want to go to England, you can't walk down the street without being attacked.
Exactly. I mean, let's face it, if someone said to you, well, Tony, you can go to Spain or you can go to Blackpool, I don't think you'd need a lot of thinking music.
All right, Jude, anything else that we need to know about at this stage?
Well, I'm sorry, I've got to talk a bit more about the food because, of course, I've been here long enough to be constipated. I have said to a waiter, there's been a cheese sandwich on the menu, and I've said to him, look, do you think I could possibly have some salad in the sandwich? And the look of horror on the man's face, I may as well have said, you know the Queen Mother is a junkie, don't you?
And I just think the fact you've got a waiter is pretty impressive, really.
But the other thing I'm completely obsessed with is the fact that whether you order a toasted sandwich or duck à l'orange, it's always going to be accompanied buy some crisps. I mean, you know what I mean? Like, when was the last time you ordered beef bourguignon in Australia and they just popped a couple of cheesels on your plate?
Hey, they've got some pretty weird Brando chips over there too, haven't they? They've got bacon chips, they've got chives, they've got everything.
They've just basically got lard, pickled onion, robin's nest up your bottom, no fibre chips. That's what they've got.
All right, Jude. Well, we might leave you to get back to the delights of Edinburgh. And here's a place I can recommend you check out. Somewhere there in Edinburgh, we saw this as a hairdresser's called Oliver Stone's Hairdressing.
If I could come out of there looking as good as him.
I'm not sure if it's him, but I went there and just sat in the chair and he said, what do you want? I said, back and to the left, back and to the left, back and to the left. And Jude, if you haven't discovered it already, there's a quite lovely watering hole called the Tilted Wig. Give that a look in.
I'll be there.
Well, the best of luck to you, Jude, and we'll speak to you next week, and good luck with the shows. Remember, you're representing your country.
Going for gold.
You've got a heart as big as Farlap. See you next week, Jude.
Au revoir.
That's Jenna Jackson and Luther Vandross here at Martin Molloy. Thanks to Judith Lucy, speaking to us from Edinburgh. Mm. And do you get the idea that maybe the festival hasn't started properly yet? She's talking about crisps and ironing boards.
Yeah, well, that's how it always starts, Tony. Yeah. That's what you call local knowledge. All right. She's sussing it out.
Well, next week, hopefully she will have partaken of some of the colour and the shows and whatever else is going on.
Are you
on.
Suggesting that segment was a bit lightweight, Tony? Is that what you're suggesting?
No, I wasn't saying that at all. Mm. And, well, speaking of segments that are just chockers with content.
Got something you want to get off your chest? Well, now's your chance, because it's time for Martin Molloy True Confessions. Maybe you've been parking in a loading zone. Perhaps you cheated on your census form. Or maybe it's just that you were the inventor of acid wash denim. Everybody has a guilty secret, but only Mick and Tony are giving you the chance to fess up and bag yourself a fabulous prize.
Basically, I just moved into a flat and I've got no fridge or anything like that.
Right.
And basically, I had no milk, no sugar. So desperate times, we went over to McDonald's and stole some UHT milk and some sugar.
Oh, dear. Of the century.
Isn't that terrible?
Well, that's an alternative to not having a fridge, moving in next to McDonald's.
All right, well, I hope you've got an oven.
Three confessors enter the booth, but only one emerges with the George Michael 3.5 pack of CDs and goes into the drawer for a trip for two to the UK to see George Michael live in concert. All thanks to Foxtel's Red Music Television. Okay, lads, let them off the hook.
We'd be glad to, Pete Smith and Gracie, if you could wheel the booth out. There's already somebody in the booth. Can you feel it?
Yep.
I certainly can. Let's step inside, open the curtain, and get the slidey door. And can you hear us? The State Liberal Member for Munding Borough in Queensland, Frank Tanti.
Good morning, boys. Good afternoon.
Frank, how are you?
Good afternoon.
That'll do. And, Frank, you may have heard we've been having a bit of a go at one of your colleagues this afternoon, but do you actually get down to the gym yourself in Parliament House?
Oh, I tried a couple of times, but I'm a little bit busy. Frank's a pretty fit guy.
All right, is he? Is he? Mm. And how have you been going since we last spoke to you? Are you an old hand at the Queensland politics game now, Frank?
I'm learning every day.
Yeah? And what have you picked up? Can you give us a tip or a pointy that you've picked up?
Oh, I just think... it's a matter of there's a lot of pressures from all angles and everything's got to be looked at, and we talk about it in the party room and then everyone gets a chance to vote before it becomes crunch time.
And what about those party room sessions, Frank? Is that all the boys rolling the sleeves up? Is there a bit of biffo there?
Yeah, it's pretty normal.
It's pretty normal, is it? Just parliamentarians going about the business of being parliamentarians.
Yeah, just being ourselves.
All right, Frank. Well, today I'm afraid we want to investigate the dark side of Frank Tanti. It's your chance to fess up and tell not only your state, but indeed the entire nation, something you've done that perhaps you shouldn't have. Anything you want to get off your chest, Frank Tanti?
Well, the big thing is I'm 47 tomorrow, but when I was 21,
yes,
I couldn't even get into the under 18s thing without producing my licence.
Is that right? You had to bring out the ID?
Yeah, every time.
And how are you going these days?
Well, it's the same old thing. As I said, I'm 47, but luckily most people think I'm about 33, but I'm not bragging.
Okay. And what do you got planned for your 47th, Frank?
Oh, a lot of hard work. There's no escape. There's a big breakfast in the morning for one of the mining groups, and right shoot, I get home about 11 o'clock after school concert.
Oh. But there's going to be no big party? There's going to be no dancing girls busting out of cakes, anything like that?
No, my wife and some friends are in the office at the moment. Give me a cake because they won't get time to see me tomorrow.
And what about in Mundingborough? There's no ticker tape parade with, you know, people dressed as you dancing about?
No, I've gone from the poisonous dwarf stage. Now I'm just known as the Mighty Midget.
Okay. Well, happy birthday, Mighty Midget.
All the best, guys.
And thanks for helping us out today. And Frank certainly gave us more than we bargained for.
There you go then.
And that's a confession.
That's a confession.
Having to, well, you didn't actually go the fake ID. I don't want to suggest that. That'll
not at all. In fact, completely the opposite. A man of age, of decent age, being refused.
Yes.
Entry.
Well, okay, that's pretty small potatoes on this segment. And it's your chance, people, now to do as Frank Tanti has done and fess up on national radio. Put yourself in the running for their trip to the UK courtesy of Foxtel's Red Music Television. Call us now, 1-800-657-657.
This is Martin Malloy.
Very amusing to begin with, very modern and light.
Brought to you by Powerade Tidal Burst. It's on the street.
Thank you very much, Frank Tandy on the Moog today. Here are True Confessions on Martin Malloy, where we just give people the opportunity to fess up to something, something they haven't told anybody, and now we're giving them the chance to tell the nation and possibly bag a prize in the process. It's a purging segment.
Yep.
Everybody feels better about themselves at the conclusion. Who have we got today, Mickey?
It's Elizabeth. Hello, Elizabeth.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm good.
Oh, you sound a bit nervous.
Nervous? No, I'm not nervous. I just think my mum might walk in on me and then she'll find out the truth forever.
Well, let's all find out the truth, Elizabeth. What are you sitting on?
Well, when I was about 11 years old, yep. I was sick at home and I was watching TV and my sister's budgies were in the kitchen and they were screaming and trying to say pretty boy and they were driving me absolutely up the wall.
Yeah.
I've always hated them because my sister loved them, so I decided that's it, they're going. So I took them out the backyard, opened the cage and let them go.
Oh, dear! And what did you tell your sister?
I told her that I'd actually let them out for their daily exercise, and the mailman came, so I ran out to get the mail, and they flew out the door when I ran out to get the mail.
Oh, they made a bolt for it. You didn't try and suggest that they'd, you know, picked the lock on the cage, left paper mache replicas of themselves in the cage. You just...
The funny thing was, they came back and sat in the backyard for a couple of days.
Did they? Just giving you the wing.
They couldn't talk, could they, Elizabeth?
All I could say was pretty boy. Well, they were trying anyway.
Pretty boy sucked in badly. And just out of interest, Elizabeth, they were disturbing you watching the telly. Can you remember what show it was?
I think it was some sort of soapy that I wasn't supposed to be watching.
Oh, I see. Well, there you go. Does it feel better to have got that out now, Elizabeth?
Yes.
I was going to call you Judith Lucy for a moment there.
Don't do that. There you go, Elizabeth.
Jeez, let a few birds go. All right, thanks, Elizabeth. Letting the sisters' budgies go. Can we go worse than that? Let's open the second window and meet Sharon. Sharon, what do you want to tell us about?
Well, I nearly burnt my parents' front veranda down with a cigarette.
Oh, how long ago was this?
About 15 years ago.
All right. And how old were you, Sharon?
15 at the time.
Oh, yeah. And did your parents know?
No. They didn't know I smoked at the time, and they'd gone out, so I jumped out of bed and thought I'd have a quick smoke on the veranda.
Yes.
And the end of it fell off down the floorboard.
Yes.
So I thought, oh, it'd be right, just put a glass of water on top of it. And I went and had a shower, and when I come out and dry myself in front of the window there, and there was all smoke at the veranda, I thought, geez, what's that?
When you stepped out of the shower, you could see...
I've got my bra and knicker on.
Locals looking at you. And
you could dry yourself on the flames.
And Sharon,
well, it wasn't quite flaming yet, but it was smoking.
And what happened when the parents came home? What was the explanation?
Well, I just said I jumped out the shower and I'm drying myself and there was smoke out the front window. I thought, what's going on here? And I've gone out and it was on fire. So I've just got the hose and, well, I actually looked for a bucket first, poured that on it, didn't go out. So I've got the hose out and squirted it and I just said, I don't know what's going on, but... And I just jumped out of the shower and here it is on fire.
You're struck by lightning, something like that.
Mum rang the police, though. Good on her.
All right.
All right.
Well, the case is closed now.
Were you questioned?
No, they just asked me what was going on and, you know, what time I saw it and when it happened and blah, blah, blah. So yeah,
and can you give us a light? I boarded a couple of Winnie Blues off you and left. All right, thanks, Sharon. Arsonist Sharon there. Let's open the third window and meet Susan. Susan, what are you confessing to?
My fiancé actually tells everyone that he works with on the council that I make these wonderful Anzac biscuits, but I actually make them out of a packet mix.
Oh, no! So you're cheating.
Well, yes.
They're counterfeit biscuits. And will your husband be listening to the program? Is the game up now, do you think?
Hopefully not. I've actually had one of the guys that he works with actually rang me up and said, oh, can I get your recipe? I said, he tried to make them himself, but he couldn't get them the same as mine.
Oh, dear. So you gave
He's obviously not following the instructions on the box.
That's obvious.
So you just made up some bogus recipe, did you?
No, I told him it was a secret recipe and he couldn't have it.
Oh, yeah, top secret. Can't fall into the wrong hands.
Well, the game's up now, Susan. And is that our winner?
Anyone peddling bogus biscuits, Tone, and fessing up to it is winner of something.
Well, guess what? You've won the 3.5-pack of CDs and you're going in the draw for the trip to the UK.
Unreal.
And are you going to make some bickies to celebrate?
Definitely.
They're not funny biscuits, are they? It's got none of the wacky stuff in them.
No, I haven't tried any of that.
Okay.
Pass them round to council and see how you go.
Then you'll see them,
though. Oh, yeah.
All right. Well, thanks, Susan. Thanks for taking part in True Confessions.
Indeed.
And I think we've done everybody a favour today. And people have owned up. And Frank Canty's owned up.
Mm-hmm.
It's a positive feeling.
It's been a job well done.
All right. And we'll be back with more confessions tomorrow. And until then, remember.
You got to accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative, and latch on to the affirmative. Don't mess with Mr. In Between. No, don't mess with Mr. In Between.
Oh, sorry about that. That's the Rembrandts. I'll be there for you. Sorry, Mick and myself were just dancing about the studio, squirting water on each other, pretending we're in the cast of Friends. That's what we do whenever that song comes on. Okay, well, Mickey, I'm glad we got to the bottom of that Anzac biscuit scam, which has been going on for several years now. I've read write-ups about it in The Australian, and Susan's fessed up, and it's good to have it. It's like when that bloke came out and said, I am anonymous. I wrote that book.
It'll be a miniseries soon. The Great Bicky Robbery.
Yes, well, we've got to the bottom of that, and if Anzac Bicky talk has got you a bit hungry, check this out.
Feel like a pizza but couldn't be bothered going out and getting one? Then pick up the phone and give us a call here at Getaway Pizza Home Delivery Service. At Getaway, all our drivers have driven Getaway cars in armed holdups, and when they deliver pizza, you want to do exactly as they say.
G'day.
Get out on the ground! What? Down on the ground! Hands behind your head now! Who ordered pizza?
Oh, I did.
Two capricciosa?
Yes.
Well, where's the money? Where's the money?
In my pocket.
All right, get it out. Slowly.
They're $15.20.
Put it in the bag.
Come on, move it. Let's go.
All right, no one gets up till we're out of here. Enjoy your meal.
You forgot the garlic bread.
It's that simple. At Getaway, we guarantee if you wait longer than 30 minutes for your pizza, you don't have to pay for it.
Hello?
Back against the wall, asshole! Give us your cash!
But it's been over half an hour. I don't have to pay for it.
Oh, is that right? Well, that is a shame. Okay, I'll just put the pizza over here next to this expensive-looking vase. Oh, dear, it's broken. Ah, there are a lot of nice things in your house that would break quite easily. Oh, that's a lovely stained glass window. Oh, aren't I the Butterfingers?
All right, here's the money. Just go.
Would you like a menu?
No, just go.
Oh, no, I've left them back at the shop. Oh, well, looks like you're going to have to come with me for a little ride. Here, put this hood on while I tie you up. Come on. Get in there.
phone call is all it takes to get piping hot pizza delivered to your door. And one phone call is all they usually allow our drivers once they've been caught by the cops.
Hello?
You order the large Hawaiian?
Yeah.
Well, we've got it. Have the money ready. We'll be there in a minute. No tricks.
What about my free 2-litre Coke?
It's in an unmarked package in a bin on the corner of Grey and Johnson Street. You can pick it up when we've got our money.
Well, what if I don't want to go through with this?
Oh, so you want to play games, do you? Well, we've got someone here you might be interested in talking to.
Hello, Dad?
My baby? All right, I'll do anything you say. I just want my girl back in one piece. Hello? Hello? Did you get it?
Wasn't long enough to put a trace on.
Damn!
So go on for the finest home delivery pizza in town. Call Getaway Pizza. And remember, we know where you live.
The new SAFM.
And just before we go today, as always, we're cleaning up the crumbs. What about this story in the paper today, Mickey, about the mind control pilots? A revolutionary control system that would enable pilots to fly passenger planes with the power of thought is being tested by the United States Air Force. So I suppose there goes Warwick Capper's chance of getting his pilot's license.
Just sitting there on the ground. Nothing's happening. It moved an inch.
But the device...
This thing's faulty.
The device will eventually allow a pilot wearing a special headband to take off, fly and land safely without using his hands, which, of course, he's using the open nose. Little packets of peanuts.
He's hands-free.
Yeah, hang on a second. You got mind control pilots. So you get...
This is your captain thinking.
Think faster. We're running late. Think faster.
What's that going to say? You have to concentrate. So you're flying a plane just with your mind. You'd have to constantly be thinking, fly the plane, fly the plane. What if you start to think, I've left the gas on.
So I'm thinking, donuts.
What do? You fly to Dunkin' Donuts.
So the plane's going round in circles. What happens if you get slightly distracted? What if someone comes in and goes, did you see Airport 75 on telly? You wouldn't be able to think about anything else.
So the plane I'm driving, you just see it pulling into the driving bowl shop. Go, no, not now.
Think happy thoughts. But I'm going to look forward to that. Mm. I hope we get to see that happening. I'm sure it's going to work. Mm. And any other news? I know good news for drinkers.
Have a look at this. That's the biggest bottle of wine I've ever seen, Tate. And in fact, they're saying that. It's the world's, have a look, the world's largest bottle of wine, expected to raise $50,000 for the National Heart Foundation. It's a one-off hand-blown 27-litre bottle of vino, and it stands at nearly 1 metre tall.
Wow.
And it holds, I think, it's about 36 normal bottles. Ooh. I'm thinking, that's a beauty, isn't it? How would you get the cork out? You'd need one of those drills they use to drill for oil or something to whack in the top of that. What about pouring? You just whack a pipe in and go to the siphon, I reckon. Just fill up as many glasses as you can. Can you get them at a bottle shop? They got a brown paper bag big enough for one of those?
I don't know.
Imagine leaving it out at the end of the night with the bag of bottles. Jesus! Have a look at that!
That's a big recycle.
Who's been drinking there?
Well, I think we can guess. When you started to read that story out, when you said the world's biggest bottle of wine...
Judith Lucy.
No, I thought you said the world's biggest bottle of wine has just been elected president of Russia. I thought that's how you were going to end that. And just before we go, good news for Greg Matthews fans. Like ourselves, recently appointed New South Wales cricket captain Greg Matthews has received an undisclosed settlement and an apology following an incident, of course, you remember this, at Perth nightclub in 1993, in which he received serious head wounds.
Mm.
Now, I'm sure everyone's thinking the same thing at home. He's got money for the serious head wounds out of the Perth nightclub or the person involved. Oh, I'd be taking the phone off the hook down at the Advanced Hair Studios.
Them some serious head wounds.
But we really must go. And we'd like to thank our guests, Judith Lucy, Frank Tanti, Deb Clark, all our gladiators and confessors. We'll be back tomorrow with the weekly Hester Report. And until then, remember, if you can't say something intelligent, you could be the next state member for Mansfield.
Martin Malloy is a misguided production in association with Half-Baked Ideas and Ill-Conceived Concepts Proprietary Limited. Brought to you by Powerade Tidal Burst. Pete Smith speaking.